Hello everybody and welcome to the webinar on book launch, The Wave of Agile. I'm Denise Garcia, your host for this hour, and I will take you through the schedule of this hour. But before that, I'd love to introduce my dear colleague and author, Dirk-Jan de Groot. Hi. Hi.
Yeah, great to see you all.
Dirk-Jan, you wrote the book, The Waves of Agile. It's finally here.
It is, yeah.
How are you feeling?
It feels great because it was a long term of writing things all virtual, having the PDFs, having the ebook, but it's all on the screen. So when you hold it in the physical copy, I think that's the cherry on the pie, and it really feels good. And I flipped through the pages, and I think it looks good. I didn't find that much errors yet, because that's always just like a scratch on your new car, right?
Yeah.
There's an error in there. But it looks good. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm really happy.
And now with all you guys, a little celebration, right?
Yeah, because we looked at the participants list, and a lot of people that I know that I worked with, clients I worked with, colleagues, friends. So it's amongst friends. It's a little celebration. I love to share that with you all.
Yeah. So to start with the schedule of this hour, our director Niels van Schaik will talk about the value of change. Then our colleague Vincent Verloop has an interview with Wilco Donna of RTL about the customer in the driver's seat. And of course, you will give a short introduction about the book.
That's the least we can do today.
At the final, we will have a Q&A for all your questions. If you have any question, just put it in the chat, and we will come to them at the end. Your book. How is it to get feedback while writing?
I hate it. It's really frustrating. because sometimes you're struggling, but sometimes you write something and think, oh, this is a great chapter. And then you send it to some colleagues for feedback. And then sometimes they say, I like this, or that's a good point you make. But very often they say, this is unclear, or this is not true, or what do you try to say here? And I really get really emotional with that. So my strategy that I learned is that I read it quickly and then I get all emotional and then I put it away as stupid. And then after an hour or the end of the day, I read it again and then without the emotions and then they're right. It's better if I change that.
And then you make a change.
And then I make the change, really like a nice boy.
Talking about change, you asked our director, Niels van Schaik, to talk about the difference
about how he deals with change,
we recorded it because of COVID, and he's sitting in our hotel
room,
and I love that room.
Yeah, me too, and it's iconic because every employee gets a little tegeltje tile. And he's always sitting in front of the tiles behind his computer. And this is how we know Niels.
Hi, my name is Niels van Schaik. And on behalf of Scurist, I welcome you at this great moment. The launch of the new book of our colleague Dirk-Jan. A book about the next level or next wave of Agile. As one of the founders of Scurist and a 70-year entrepreneur, there were several moments when we had to embrace change. The leading principle through all of these years was agility. The power to adapt and to embrace the change. In 16 years, we have grown from a small startup with only a couple of employees to where we are now. We had to learn the hard way that things that work in a small company are not automatically working in a larger one. So we had to learn a lot. At times, we were a bit too agile, sometimes too inflexible, even stiff. Sometimes we were way too fast or too early. Sometimes we were adapting way too slow and missed opportunities. Sometimes we were even spot on. We tried self-management concepts. We worked even without a clear goal and direction. Some changes came from within our organizations and others came from outside. From both types of change, we learned a lot. One thing that stands out for me is that change is omnipresent and inevitable. We have to accept that changes come even if you don't like it. You can choose to let it hit you like a thundering wave, or ride the wave and adapt. For me, there are three core lessons to be learned from the experiences we had the privilege of learning. At first, put your long-term goal in place. You have to determine your endpoint if you want to get from A to B. It's important to explain what the B looks like Dirk Jan says in its book, this will help you to get people along. Place this in a 5-year horizon and share your vision, but realize that you will never, okay, hardly ever arrive at the sketched B. You will overperform, find your way around various obstacles, and life will happen to you. But the long-term plan will give you direction. Please don't carve it in concrete. When you have your picture of your future goal, define your own 1-year plan, your quarterly goals, and evaluate, learn, and adapt. Make your year a set of sprints per team in which you move step by step in the direction of your B. It is important to give the team the autonomy to execute and support them when needed. In this process, you evaluate the how in relation to your why. While on your way, at special moments, reset your goal and repeat this process with military precision. The second lesson that I learned is, in many situations, you don't have much influence on what life throws at you. You have a choice, on the other hand, in the way you let it affect you and how you respond to it. This was put in great words before by Viktor Frankl and Edith Eger in some epic books. In the book of Dirk Jan, I recognize the concept as well when he discusses the 6 deciding factors of a transformation. Know your models, and above all, you have to acquire a growth mindset. Lesson 3. Let people shine in their talent and in activities that make them shine. In a lot of situations, we judge or evaluate people and co-workers on the skills they lack instead of the competences in which they excel. If either one of them is out of place, we can better stop pushing and trying, find the talent and act on it. Last but not least, the book Waves of Agile has an important word on the cover: surfing. The word is not part of the title, but for me, it expresses the pleasure that change can bring. When the next wave of Agile is coming, get on your board and ride the change. All things concerned, Dirk Jan's book can be seen as a useful tool that makes it easier to embrace the constant and certain change. Combined with a great set of life lessons, this book is a must read for Agile fanatics, enthusiasts, and all of you who come along change in a complex, skilled environment. Stay on your toes, stay focused on your goal, adopt a growth mindset, and do those things that make you tick. If you would like to know more about these lessons we learned, feel free to contact me. And of course, buy the book. Congratulations, Dirk Jan, for delivering this marvelous result, and have a nice day.
Well, that was the presentation of Niels. He talks about going too fast and going too slow. Dirk Jan, do you recognize it?
Yeah, you always want to go too fast, at least for transformations, but it doesn't work that way because you have to get people with you and persuade them, and they need to adapt. This morning somebody said me, like, you dream faster than you run, or something like that, expressing the same thing. Like, in your head you want to make big steps, but in real life it takes some time. I've been in many organizations where getting the people in the meeting takes 3 weeks.
Yeah.
So when you wake up in the morning and say, like, oh, let's do something, we just do a meeting and then we'll progress.
Yeah.
Then it's when you get on the work floor, like, oh, that will take some more time.
Yeah.
So, you have to take your time.
Yeah, and going too slow, do you also recognize that?
Yeah, you shouldn't go too slow. because, well, in the book I state that important for leadership is that communicate about the transformation and what you want to change and how you want the organization to be, and emphasis that the transformation is ongoing and happening. Because if there's no momentum, then people, well, you start with a kickoff, a lot of noise, and then nothing happens, and they just turn away and start doing the things they were doing all the time, and then nothing happens.
Yeah.
So there's a balance between going as fast as you can, but not losing momentum, not going too fast and losing people, because you need to make some steps in order to experience and learn what's important in the next step.
Yeah, so...
So it's a balance.
So, and you talk about the balance in your book.
Yeah.
In your book, you also have a preface, but you have not one person...
I got two.
You got two.
I got two.
Can you explain why?
Yeah, we're talking about prefaces, and I'm really pleased that Ivan Bernekom wrote a preface. And for people that might not know that, Ivan Bernekom is one of the guys that wrote the Agile Manifesto.
The Holy Grail, right?
The Holy Grail. So... he was there when it happened. I think all Agile enthusiasts are kind of envying, like they wanted to be part of that because it's a historic moment.
Yeah.
And Ari was that. And he wanted to write my preface.
And great.
That's awesome. And the funny thing is that he emphasized on the Agile coach part of the book. So he's telling things from an Agile transformation perspective.
Yeah.
And then I watched LinkedIn and I saw a film by Wilco Donna, who I know, that's why I watched it. And he was telling what he was trying to do with his organization. And I thought it was spot on. I thought that what he is doing is actually what I'm trying to explain in the book about value delivery.
It was just your story.
Yeah. So I gave him a ring and said, like, do you want to do my preface?
And there it is.
And then we made small history.
Yes, your own history.
Yeah.
our colleague Vincent Verloop had the privilege to interview Wilco Donna, head of products at RDL. And because of COVID, we also pre-recorded this. And they talk about the customer in the driver's seat. Shall we look at it?
I'm really looking forward to it.
Good afternoon. My name is Vincent Verloop. I'm Agile Coach for Squarist. And today I have the opportunity to have a talk with Wilco Donna. Wilco is Head of Consumer Products for RTL the Netherlands. RTL is mostly known for the Dutch TV channel and also the video streaming service Videoland. Wilco has a broad experience in product management and consultancy in companies on an agile journey. Welcome, Wilco.
Thanks
for having this talk.
Nice intro. Thanks.
Thank you. So, Wilco, you have written the preface of the book The Waves of Agile.
Yeah.
And I loved reading your preface. And the first question I want to ask you is, in your preface, you wrote that the journey of becoming agile is rewarding. Can you tell me something about that?
Yeah, to me, what is most rewarding? Yeah, there's a lot of elements, but to me, looking back at working in teams that are really successful and in an agile way, what I remember most is the fun we had. You are as a group of people together. You have your struggles, you have your convictions, you have a clear common goal, and achieving that goal is something really rewarding for everybody in that team. And while you're doing it, because it's something that is important to you and it's something part of what you're good at, you also have a lot of fun. So there are special periods. I mean, there's teams that I worked with almost 5 years ago that still we meet each other in kind of reunions, or we talk to each other on topics where we are now in our lives. Professionally, we do not deal with each other. So that says something to me, how special that period was for everybody in that team. And that to me is still the most rewarding looking back on those periods. Yeah.
And when you said we had a lot of fun and we experienced a lot of, did a lot of things together. Does it also mean that you have some ups and downs?
Ups and downs always. I think if you are in teams, you are trying to, if it's important enough, you're trying to achieve something that's difficult. So of course there's going to be ups and downs. And I think what distinguishes a fun and a successful team versus other teams is that how you deal with the ups and downs. And if you're able to, for example, have confrontations within the team, without breaking the trust and the relationship in the team. So yeah, ups and downs. I think it would be strange if you didn't. Yeah,
and also the downs and the periods that are very difficult also form the team and well make sure that if you fix it, the fun comes back and it even means more for the team that you've reached the goal.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think a goal that's difficult to achieve, of course, is more rewarding than anything.
Nice. So what other kinds of rewards do you use when you try to convince other professionals or colleagues on joining the journey to an agile company?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I think there is no good answer to that question. What you see, if people are used to a certain style of working or a method of working, is taking a risk when you take that agile journey and convincing people to do that. I think the only way to do that in the end is for them to experience it. So what I usually go for, I think having the goal central and combining a business goal with personal goals for everybody in the team and really making them relevant, that should inspire in taking the risk and just taking a leap of faith and going for the journey together. Because no two agile teams are the same. There's no cookbook or there's no right way to do it. I think it depends on what you want to achieve, what people are together and in what organization you are. So it's difficult, and there's always people that don't want to or have reservations or don't see how it should work or see the risks. And to me, I try to focus more on the energy of the people who want to get along and hope that those people that have a lot of reservations when they see it working will join in instead of trying to convince them on some rational way to take them, because I think that doesn't work like that. No.
Okay, clear. What do you think when you look at professionals joining the journey to an agile company? What is essential for professionals in sense of skills or character?
Yeah. To me, an open mind and curiosity is maybe one of the most important skills if you want to go for the transformation of that new way of working. And we all know about multidisciplinary teams. And you find, of course, all the skills and the competences that you need to reach your result, what you need for that product. But in the end, if you had to choose, I'd rather have people with the right mindset that still have to learn the competences and the skills that are needed to achieve the result, than to have really experienced people on the skill set. That are reluctant to have the, whether it's the Scrum values or to go for an iterative approach or to manage risks in a different way as you do agile. I think that's most important.
Yeah. So it's very much about also behavior and what you would like to see.
Yeah, behavior and the mindset and not being afraid to fail being. And having also a building relationship basically, because if you're building a team, so having trust to one another and trust means vulnerability, so also being vulnerable.
Yeah. So you mentioned being able to fail. Is that difficult to introduce in a company, because we are not very used to admitting that you have failed or?
Yeah, that's a subject by itself. And I think it's also very, that's one of those elements you can talk about it, but how do you get into a culture of a company that it's okay to fail? I think what we did in one company, I really liked that we did fail parties, so even higher management and so getting people on stage and tell about something that really they screwed up.
Celebrate that you failed.
Yeah. Just to show, because that's the only way you can. Of course, everybody sees the clips on YouTube and understands. Yeah, wouldn't it be great if you fail? But to really allow that and to show that in your work is difficult still to me. Yeah.
One sentence in your preface really caught my eye, and I'm gonna read it for you. Ideally, we want our customer to drive our roadmap based on the data they provide us. Can you tell us how Agile would help to reach that ambition?
Yeah. To me, I think that's the most important why for me personally behind Agile. I mean, why go to this new method of iterative working and learning loops and short cycles? To me, it has to do with this. If you want to introduce a successful product, you need to understand what the customer wants. And the only thing, the only way I think to get that is to get data from the customer's behavior next to asking questions and doing surveys and getting feedback. But the only way to really understand what they want is basically experiment on them, do A-B test or set-based design. Mm-hmm. And to me, what Agile gives is the room to be short cycled, so have a short feedback loop, to learn from what you're doing, and to have a really short way from your idea, call it a hypothesis, to what you do in the market. So that to me is the, I think that's a necessity even. Yeah,
and it sounds like really common sense, right? Listen to the customer. But if I hear you talk about it, it takes a lot to be able to listen to the customer and to respond.
That's it, because it's always it seems very difficult to if we have a fantasy of our product and we have of the end state, that usually takes a while to build, and that's the risk, right? Because that fantasy of what we think the product is, maybe it isn't. So being able to cut that down into little pieces and making sure that you validate each step that you have with real customers, that's what makes it exciting and scary too sometimes. Yeah.
Well, right. This is really great to hear your vision on this. So since you wrote the preface of the book, I can imagine that you already have a copy. And if I would give you an extra copy of the book, is there someone you can think of that you would like to give the book and that that would really help this person?
Well, of course, after this book presentation, I hope I get a big stack of the book, so I can share that with a lot of people. But I really like to do that on a serious level. I like to give books as an inspiration. I did that with my team in the beginning of this year. Inspired on product management, and I think what this book does and what books do if you give them away, if it connects with you, and this book connected with me, that the ideas in that book, if you give them as a present, the conversations that lead from it, if you can discuss the book, always give me new insights, and at least that works much better than trying to convince or explain concepts yourself. When it's done within a book, you both have your own view on what you read, and you have great conversation based on it. So there's a lot of people I'm looking forward to giving this book to.
Yeah. Great. Well, let's hope that that you and the book will inspire a lot of people on their Agile journey. It was really nice having this talk with you, very inspirational. And thank you very much. And I wish you all the best.
Thank you, Vincent.
Okay.
Great interview.
Well, that was the interview between Vincent and Wilco. They talk about fun and experimenting. How is that with the wave and surfing?
Yeah, and fun, I think.
Yeah, fun.
So if you go surfing, you have to experiment, you have to try it, because you get on the board, you fall off it, and you get back on, because you don't have the skills straight away.
No,
and
definitely
I think Agile is not straight out of the box. So you have to learn and adapt and find your way how you do your Agile working. So that aligns with the surfing. Niels was talking about embracing change, and I think if change comes in waves, you can be scared of the next wave and run from it.
Yeah.
You can look the wave in the eye and look what it is and then try to get on it. And surfers do that. They anticipate on the next wave and they try to master it. And I think Wilco is talking about fun factor, but when you learn, it gets energy, and when you master the wave, it feels good.
Yeah, it feels great, surfer, right?
Yeah, as a surfer, but in an organization, trying to get further, trying to get that value delivery going.
Yeah.
If you make progress, talking about going fast or going slow, despite the space, the pace, when you make that progress and you make those steps, it feels great and that's fun. Yeah. So I really liked the surfing analogy for the fun part and the mastering the situation.
Yeah, great. I sometimes want to surf when I'm on holiday, and yeah, it's great to be on your board, but it's like 2 seconds, so I have to try more. But it's a very fun experience to do. Well, before going to the Q&A, we promised everybody you would give a short introduction of the book.
Yeah, that's so the least we can do, I think, on a book launch. Give some idea about the book, because we're talking about waves and surfing.
In a preface.
So what's the book about? Good question. And I brought myself along to answer that question. I'm really pleased today to give you a small introduction into my new book, The Waves of Agile. The Waves of Agile is all about value delivery in medium and large scale organizations. But before we dive into the value delivery itself, it might be nice to start thinking about why we do it in the first place. And there's one goal that binds us all, and that's customer satisfaction. We need to keep the customer satisfied for him to come back to us, buy our goods, buy our services, and we need to understand what finds him interesting, what's value to him. So if we understand what the customer wants, we understand why we're building the stuff that we're building, why we're making the solutions that we're making, and why we're doing the development in the way that we do it. And that will be, in most cases, especially if you read the book, about Agile, because Agile helps us to make small batches, bring them in production, and learn from it how it's being perceived by the customer and how it's been valued by the customer. But there's a problem with that. Because if we do single team agile, it's fairly easy. But if we scale that up to medium and large organizations, it gets more difficult. The structure and the culture of the organizations make it more difficult to do a nice agile way of working. It's being challenged. So something is needed. We don't need to have the goal only, but we need a plan. And we end up with doing agile transformations. We have agile journeys that we embark on. And talking about agile journeys, that reminds me of a talk that I had with a potential client of mine, and that's years ago, where he asked me somewhere in the talk, like, Dirk-Jan, if we embark on that agile journey, if we start embracing agile, what can I expect? What will happen? What problems will I run into? And how do I anticipate those? Do I need to do that? And how do I communicate about that? And that's years ago, and I don't really recall what I answered. I think I gave him a really fair answer. But I always had the feeling that I didn't give him the answer that he deserved, and I didn't have the formulation yet, the words for that answer, until now, because I think this book provides just that answer. And although each organization is unique, and although every journey is unique, and organizations need to take their own path, I think there are some patterns that I see in the organizations that I worked with that I'd like to share with you in the book and now. So I recognize 3 waves, and I see that a lot of organizations start with a strong focus on the teams. They learn the teams to do their trick, to do their scrum, their Kanban, their ceremonies, their events, and how they can transform, well, backlog items into potential shippable products. And it takes some effort, and some organizations and some people really have to get used to that, because it's different than they remember. But it's fairly easy. But organizations that see that teams get the drift of that and start speeding up understand that in order to have business impact and in order to have releases that really make an impact, they need to integrate the work of several teams into one technical release. So the second wave is all about inter-team alignment, managing dependencies, dividing the work over the various teams and integrating it again into a technical release and put that in production. And that's difficult. And a lot of organizations are still struggling with that. But once they get the hang of that, they'll understand and retrace back to what they actually started with the business value. So they need to find ways to actually benefit from the technical release, embed that in the organization. So organizational readiness and target operating model might be topics that's interesting. How do you measure the value of your technical release? And does that actually, the decisions that you made actually help you to make more profit or make more happy customers? And we embed the agile way of working in the different layers of the organization. So also higher management will need to learn how to do agile planning and how to support the development and how to help to become the organization agile as a whole, agile business. And understanding these waves helps us to recognize where we are. And I made a table, the three waves of agile table, where for several topics, I explain what challenges organizations are struggling with, depending on where they are in their agile journey. And you will understand that organizations that are in the first wave are struggling with different things, more team-related things, than organizations that are in the second wave or in the third wave. So the challenges shift over time. And having the table makes it easy to recognize them, to anticipate on them, communicate about them, like I know this is a challenge and we recognize that, but we find this thing more important first to deal with, so that corresponds better with the wave that we are. But it also helps to find solutions for that. And yes, we cannot really plan the agile journey full ahead. We need to be adaptive. But whenever we encounter a problem or a challenge, we need to find a solution for that. And in the chapter about agile transformation, I explain ingredients of a successful transformation. And I think these aspects help you to come up with a solution that's worthwhile and that's sustainable. And it's more than talking about processes. It's more about talking about leadership, about techniques as well, culture and mindset. And that helps us to get sustainable solutions and helps us to find something that actually works. If we acknowledge that the transformation changes over time and we're having different challenges that we're dealing with when we proceed on our agile journey, you wouldn't be surprised to acknowledge that the work of the agile coach is changing as well. Agile coaches in a third wave organization will find that they're being asked different things. They need to learn new skills. They need to help the organization with other stuff than they did a few years ago. So one part of the book is about how the agile coach is changing in the third wave. And that's some kind of beacon that we can use to align ourselves and focus on while we develop our services and ourselves. So I think agile coaches get to a crossroad and can decide whether they want to become a team coach or remain a team coach and really help the teams with becoming high performing. But some people prefer to be a development delivery coach, which has a more technical aspect. The delivery coach typically helps teams to embrace the agile practices like continuous integration and deployment, virtualization, automation, that kind of stuff. But he sits with the team and helps them conducting pilots and embracing that technology, but also puts that on the management table. So he has a role with leadership to measure the flow, measure the performance of the delivery flow, and maybe make that an address on the management table in order to get time and commitment to invest in that and go then to the teams to help them. And other people like leadership coaching very much. So the profile of the agile counselor is typically a leadership coach that walks the floor, smells the place, and addresses things to the leadership team, like maybe pay attention to this and that, but also gives feedback on the leadership team on how their reaction and how their way of working and their patterns influence the success of the transformation. So there are three roles of agile coach, and we can use that to think what we want to be, develop capabilities and stay in demand. And we can explain with that what we want to do in the organization and how we can help them. And if you look at the different profiles and map the six items, success criteria of an agile transformation on that, you can see by the colors that those profiles are quite different in their perspective. But we need all those perspectives for successful transformations. So an important message in the book is that agile coaches and leadership teams need to collaborate to make it a success. But not only agile coaches and leadership team, also Scrum Masters and product owners need to collaborate in order to empower the teams and have that value delivery going on. And in the book, I explain how you can align roles and how you can have a discussion about role conflicts and ensure that everybody knows what is part of. The change management process is described in a separate part, which I think is some kind of the backbone of the change and the value delivery. So in five items, I explain how you make a roadmap that shows what you're doing and how you can communicate with that, what your plans are and what dependencies you are, how you can do proper refinement, the process of getting the acceptance criteria on the table so you know what you need to build, how you can progress, measure progress and manage dependencies by having portfolio board, talking about dependencies, which is really important in the second wave. I list several types of dependencies and explain what you can do with that and how you can embed it in your refinement process. And I explain in a chapter that I wrote with Nika Alma about Obeya rooms, in which you can track progress of your change, but also about your transformation. The sixth part in the book is about built-in quality, because it's not only about value delivery, it's also about value quality delivery. And I use the development cycle to create a system of validated learning where you can see and learn where faults are injected and where you can eliminate wastes in order to have a smooth flow and get to production more smoothly and get earlier feedback from your customers. And there's a problem with that, because I think effective development is all about embracing the right practices. And there are a lot of practices available. I list a lot of them in my book as well. But a lot of teams and organizations are really busy, so they don't have time to do a lot of experimenting and a lot of improvements without results. So we need to be spot on in selecting the right practices to make that improvement and to have more commitment for making more improvements in the next step. So if you have all those practices, where do you start? SAFe says, for instance, if you want to do built-in quality, you should do BDD. But if one team is doing BDD, do you build quality in? Well, this table helps you to align the practices with the development steps. And if you do analysis in which step you have the most problem or the most bottlenecks, you can find out which practices you do. But the book is about the three waves of Agile. And that's a thread throughout the whole story. So I thought it was a nice exercise to map the practices on the waves as well. And then you get a clear picture of which practices are very interesting for first wave organizations and which challenges or practices maybe are a little bit too far ahead for your organization because you're not in the third wave yet. So that gives you a handheld to have targeted improvements and not spend too much time on things that don't yield results or do not really fit the face of the organization that you're in. So the three waves are a thread throughout the book and it helps you to understand the transformation, to plan your agile journey. It helps you to develop the coaching capabilities and align the services that agile coaches deliver with the needs of the organization. So agile coaches can actually support the leadership team and make an impact or a difference. And it helps you to select the right practices and embrace them in order to yield a better value quality delivery. And that's the book in a nutshell. And I hope you're triggered by it and interested by it. And I hope you enjoy the read.
Well, that was the short introduction of your book. Now, the Q&A.
Yeah.
All the questions.
Maybe there's some questions.
Yeah. Well, I will take a look in the chat. First of all, congratulations from Uruguay.
Great.
The first question is, how can you anticipate for the next wave?
Yeah, I think that we first that came in the question when we're talking about anticipating on the waves and the surfing part.
Yeah.
I really like the question, and I kind of have given the answer maybe in the presentation I just gave. But there's a table in the book which explains the three waves and different challenges that you encounter on various topics. And I think if you recognize that the characteristics of your transformation change if you progress on your agile journey, and if you look at different challenges that become interesting if you're further ahead in your journey, you can anticipate on that. And, yeah. And you can, he says, managers become agile leaders. That might not be the first thing you think about.
Yeah.
But once it's set, you can anticipate on that and see, is that already relevant here? Or shall we wait with the topic and focus on something else?
So there are very many answers and questions about which wave you have to do what, yeah, or what you can expect.
Yeah, so I think it gives some guidelines, this book.
He answered also with yes, it was with the surf part. So you had a good, you had it right. Another question is, what is the story about the squirrel in your book?
I got some questions from that. So Andrew, if you're listening, I said to Andrew, think about it. I will tell you on the book lounge.
Oh yeah.
But I believe this is a question from somebody else.
Yeah.
The reason why I wrote this book is because I wrote this book in 2016.
Yeah, but
and I learned a lot since then.
Yeah.
So I thought it's time for a sequel.
Yes.
And this book has a rabbit on it, and I didn't want to use the rabbit.
No. So
I wanted to move on. So we had some thoughts, and then I thought, why not use a different animal? And we had a deep thought about the animal. But since I'm working for Squirrist, and the mascot of Squirrist is a squirrel,
yes,
it's a little bit in the name.
Yeah.
I thought, let's put a squirrel in there. And somewhere in the book, I explain all the characteristics of the squirrel and why that fits perfectly on the cover of this book.
Great. I hope that answers the question. Then also we have a question, why is functional and non-functional testing not done before a user story is done? Or maybe I interpret the global incorrectly. Sorry.
Yeah, I think you can do that as soon as possible and you shoot. And maybe even on the paper, if you're talking about performance as non-functional aspect.
Yeah.
If you can test that while you're still on the paper, I think that would even be good.
Okay.
So don't wait with that. But there is some logic in it where you want to have the functional things, and then you can do more testing.
Next question is, in our Agile Safe organization, business owners create change based on epics and are responsible for delivery business value. How does this fit in the story of the book?
That's a good question, especially if you have to embrace all safe in your answer. It's really a challenge. I think it fits the story because I talk about safe, but I talk also about less and Nexus. So I don't want to stick with one framework.
Oh.
I talk a lot about the product owner,
yeah,
but also talk about the CPO, and I think the CPO role can be found in different frameworks. As a higher level product owner,
yeah,
and that guides and prioritizes the change, so I think it fits in perfectly.
So yeah, I think that that's a good answer. And if the person wants
if
to
not send talk, me an email,
we'll talk and more and with then, you about it,
and we'll discuss that offline.
Is a wave created or does a wave arise?
That's a good one. Nobody asked me. I never thought about that. I think there's a natural phase going. So in the first wave, there's a lot of focus on the teams.
Yeah.
And I use words in the book like, once the team gets up to steam,
yeah,
we learn that they have a lot of output, and then the attention shifts from single team output to combining those outputs.
Yeah.
So there's some kind of logical thing when you're working on certain challenges, especially in the start where the team is struggling and trying to get those user stories done, the focus is naturally there.
Yeah.
And you can maybe trigger a new wave and go as an agile coach, walk in the organization, say, oh, we should go across team because it's important. But people are working on getting that single team done.
Yeah.
So when they get the hack of that, they logically transfer to looking around them a little bit. They get new headspace, and then like, what else is important?
Yeah. Next question is, did I just see the V model in a circle?
Um, I'm struggling with that because in the circle you get some gated process which might look at a little bit like fee model. The fee model is all about feedback loops.
Yeah.
And is about getting early feedback creating tests in advance.
So maybe
there is some sequential stuff there, but the fee model was originally intended to be small iterations as well, and it's misused by a lot of organizations in making it long cycles.
So there is
something there, but I think the difference is that we're talking not about test departments doing tests, but about teams working together in order to get that value delivery. And I still think that it's worthwhile to have a discussion about when can we detect deviations and what do we do then? And if that's done using a fee model, well, in a fee model, you can shift left and shift up as well.
Yeah.
As long as you get effective value delivery, I think it doesn't really matter.
Okay. That's clear. Someone here says, hi DJ, how do you anticipate on situations where several departments in the same large enterprise are on different waves?
I think that will always be the case. So don't try to put all the people in one wave. And I had that table, I closed the book, but there were different topics, right? With challenges, I can't find it now. But maybe for one topic, you're further ahead than others.
Yeah.
So in general, it goes in waves, but some teams might be further ahead on certain topics. But it doesn't really matter because it's more a thinking model than a box that you want to stuff people in. It's about what is interesting now, what challenges should I be working on, and what's the next challenge?
Yeah. Yeah, and in the natural waves, there are also big and small ones, and sometimes.
So throughout the book, I try to have phrases like, this is a handheld, it guides you.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work in your organization that way, deviate. If you disagree, deviate, think for yourself, tune it, because it's not the golden model that you should apply strictly. It doesn't have a trademark.
It's a guidance.
Make it your own, it's a guidance.
Yeah. There is another question. How do you think we fight the huge, strong marketing arm and complexity that companions like Safe are bringing to the market?
You have to repeat that again.
Yeah, sorry. I will let you read it because it's a little
bit. How do you think we fight the huge, strong marketing arm and complexity companies like Safe? I think the interpretation is that there are organizations that sell a model and really push that forward with trainings and a delivery model and a earning model. So they might not have the best interest in the company, but have interest in selling their stuff. I always, and that's what Ari picked out of his our interview in his preface.
Yeah.
I always like to step above the model, how difficult that is for models like Safe, how difficult that is for organizations that comply to a model and say, we do Safe or Nexus or less. I try to do what's common sense and don't do things because they're in the model, but because it's logical to do that.
Yeah.
That's, I think, the answer.
Yeah. That were all the questions in the chat. I have one left, and that's, where can they buy your book?
Yeah. I'm not sure whether it's available, because it should be available today.
Okay.
But you can pre-register and order it already at for the Dutch people, bol.com. At Amazon, it's available, especially .nl and .de.
Yeah.
I'm not sure whether the US is already available, because the book came in last Thursday with a slight delay.
Yeah.
And it takes some time to process that. And you can go to TechWatch, the publisher, which sells them as well.
Okay. Before sending you to a lovely afternoon, we have still a surprise for the audience.
Oh yeah.
Right?
Yeah. If you stick around, we're going to do a raffle and we're going to give away 3 books. And we put everybody that subscribed to the webinar. So if you came in by the link, you're not in our lists. Sorry for that. But if you're on the list, you make a chance of getting the book.
Well, putting this, will you give the wheel a spin for the first winner? Let's see who's the first winner. It's Juliette. And another spin for the second one. There are a lot of names, so Danielle is the second winner. And a last spin.
The last one.
So the last one.
If you didn't get one, this is your chance.
Go, go, go. It's Arnold.
Great.
So I will send everybody email.
Because you registered, so we have your address.
Yeah, so I will send you an email. Please send me your address and you will get the book. Congratulations.
You want to sign it?
Of course,
yeah,
a signed version.
Yeah, cool.
We almost forgot. It will be a signed version. So it's a one of a kind. And read it, talk about it, connect with Dirk-Jan, talk about it, and have a lovely afternoon.
Let's surf the waves.
Yes. Bye-bye.